could you call a roll, including guests?
Yes. President Lauer.
Present.
Director Hubbies.
Present.
Director Dillingham.
Here.
Director Balfour.
Here.
Director Weifels.
Here.
And staff present on the Zoom are Connie Brodell, Tim Collier, Kenny Frentress, Les Holman, Chris Hamilton, Laura Hitt, Alan Kennedy, Ashley Knott, Cassandra Olvin, Chief Weiss, and Attorney Bob Blackwell.
Well, welcome everybody. Good to see you. And we have just one agenda item mainly right now for the workshop, and we have an hour and a half to discuss it. I believe with our regular meeting, Newberg is going to be coming in right at 3, aren't they, Ashley? For the urban renewal presentation. So we may need to move our regular session agenda around a little bit to accommodate, but we'll be fine. So with that, Chief, do you want to lead this off, or you just want to turn it over to Cassandra?
Both. I'll say hello and welcome to the June meeting. And then, and it's good to see you all. And then I turn it over to Chief Olvin.
Okay.
Perfect. And I am ready to share my screen, Ashley. There we go. All right. Okay. Can everyone see the screen?
Yes, I can. Excellent.
All right, so good afternoon, members of the board and President Lauer. Today, as you mentioned, we'll be discussing tax increment financing and economic and community development. In advance of this meeting, I did send you kind of the last presentation that we had from the November board meeting. We are going to revisit a couple of the items that we discussed during that meeting, but we're also going to go into a little bit more of the specifics about how tax increment financing works to inform the discussion that we'll have about your board policy. So as you likely remember from the past, there are multiple different economic and community development funding tools that cities and counties in Oregon can use. We have these plans in all of these different kinds of plans being utilized within our service area. That includes vertical housing zones, affordable housing tax exemptions, strategic investment programs, enterprise zones, and urban renewal. But we will just be focusing on urban renewal for today's discussion. A little bit about the law. ORS 457 is the law that governs urban renewal in Oregon. And back in 2009, and frankly for many years prior to 2009, you may recall that Tualatin Valley Fire and Rescue participated in multiple different legislative efforts to try and include special districts and all the overlapping taxing districts in conversations around urban renewal because of the foregone revenue that we sustain. So it wasn't until 2009 that those legislative efforts were successful. And that was a pretty Herculean undertaking to get everybody to agree, including at the time the Oregon Association of Redevelopment Agencies. But those House bill changes that were made in 2009 basically brought us to the table in a more formal capacity. It required that three of the largest four overlapping taxing districts would have to agree to substantial plan amendments. That applies to both increasing the duration of time associated with a plan, as well as when there are significant plan amendments that increase the maximum indebtedness. And it also set limits on the size and debt that can be allowed for urban renewal plans. And that's basically a percentage of both acreage as well as valuation within the city. So we cruised along in 2009. There was what was deemed a peace treaty amongst all the different partners that came together to get House Bill 3056 unanimously passed, that there wouldn't be any more legislation brought forward specific to urban renewal for at least 7 years. Back in 2018, there was interest in revisiting the legislation around urban renewal, specifically around public buildings, because it's fairly agreed to that public buildings do not necessarily invite private investment. And so that basically was an additional item that would require concurrence from three of the four largest taxing districts. It also included some accountability measures so that every year overlapping taxing districts could get an updated version of the financial impact that they would sustain as a result of urban renewal. So CFO Collier and I both get updates from all of our urban renewal agencies to see how those plans are performing. And that's one of the means that we monitor existing plans. So let's talk a little bit more basically about how urban renewal works. Prior to any urban renewal plans being proposed, there's a whole lot of work that our cities and counties will do. That includes planning processes, feasibility studies. Often they audit and inventory how much acreage they have within their city or county that can be used for commercial or industrial purposes. They identify areas considered to be blighted. And that basically is a precondition that is necessary by virtue of that ORS 457 statute, that there has to be underdevelopment or underutilization of a property. There has to be inadequate infrastructure, which could include streets and utilities. There might be poor condition of buildings, basically conditions that do not encourage private investment or commerce in any way, and thus stagnate the tax base and can eventually, in theory, lead to degradation of other surrounding areas. So once a city or county has done all of those things, as part of their feasibility study, they contemplate how they might be able to finance improvements to revitalize an area. If one of their identified funding strategies includes urban renewal, then they start to do the planning process. And that can be years in the making. For the City of Newburgh's plan, for example, that you'll be hearing about today, they have spent years doing the planning process associated with it. I've been on a committee for nearly 2 years now that has been part of that process. And they've actually been talking about urban renewal for 20 years. So I won't go into too much more detail because you'll be hearing from city staff about their plan. But a lot happens before you see an urban renewal plan. Things that have to be included in that plan are, you know, the goals and the outcomes affiliated with that you can measure for plan performance. They draw a boundary around the area. And they have to justify that boundary. The example in the photo that you see, or the image you see on the right, is the Tiger Triangle plan. And that boundary, or the amount of acreage that can be included in that boundary, is again a statutorily mandated maximum that they can have. And that maximum amount of acreage that they can have in urban renewal includes all plans that they might have. So, for example, with the City of Tigard, they had an existing city center plan. So when they were beginning the process to identify the Tiger Triangle as a planning area, it could only be a certain size. So they really have to get strategic, and this work is even done at the committee level. Before it's formally proposed to their urban renewal agency and their community, they really have to justify where that boundary exists. They have to identify preliminary projects and programs, and this is typically at the staff level where I will contribute input. And financial analysis has to occur, which includes what the impact would be should the urban renewal plan actually occur to all the overlapping taxing districts. Then they also have to identify funding gaps or any impediments that would exist to development. And in most, in fact, frankly, all of the urban renewal plans that either exist or are potentially coming online in our service area, they have a lot of other funding sources that they utilize. So that could be federal grants, that could be general fund monies for the city, that could be private investments that they get commitments from developers in advance. So they don't typically solely rely on the tax increment financing to make their projects happen. So once they've done all that, or kind of concurrently with when they're doing all that work, they establish advisory committees and they will establish an urban renewal agency for nearly every single one of our cities. Their city council also serves as their urban renewal agency. So they will, you know, they'll convene their regular city council meeting, and then they'll end that and they'll start an urban renewal agency meeting to consider any issues. They also, the committees and advisory councils that exist for urban renewal, they will make recommendations to the urban renewal agency after all the work is done. So with Newburgh, for example, whom you'll hear from tonight, they have provided updates to the city council and their urban renewal agency, but they have not formally recommended the plan. That will happen after they've done all their presentations to the overlapping taxing districts. So tonight you will not be approving Newburgh's plan. They are just advising and informing TVF&R. They don't have any public buildings within their plan, so there's nothing for us to render, you know, a voter approval on. And then concurrent with both the development of the plan, and then when it's getting closer to adoption, they will do a lot of public involvement. That public involvement, like nearly every other process over the last couple of years, has been hampered due to the pandemic. So for our cities that have had new urban renewal plans come online, they've really had to rely on social media, mailers, online forums to try to inform people about what's happening. So let's talk about the financing. So I think you all very much know that we forego revenue if there is an urban renewal plan. The way that that happens is at the time of the plan's adoption, the assessed valuation within the plan area, that gets basically frozen for purposes of remitting tax revenue to all the taxing districts within that area. As you know, assessed valuation grows by 3% at least per year. So between that automatic growth that occurs, as well as any new development that occurs within the plan area, that extra amount above the frozen base, that's the increment that they use to pay for projects. They also might borrow against future valuation within that area to finance projects that occur. And so the base remains frozen for until basically all the debt for that urban renewal plan area is repaid. And bonds and levies are exempt from that. So that was a change that occurred via legislation as well, that basically anybody that has a bond or levy, which includes TVF&R, they will be levying on the entire valuation of the area within the urban renewal plan. So one of the things that staff is keen to monitor is the timing of plans that are reaching their maturity point, because even though a plan might say it's a 25-year plan, it's actually a function of when they repay that debt. And so they could have just a little bit of debt left and our base remains frozen. So we're careful to communicate with the cities to make sure that they're paying down that debt as soon as possible. And in some cases, have actually had part of the urban renewal plan area returned early to us, where we start levying the full amount even before that plan has been retired. That is one of the things that we kind of negotiate with our partners on, to see if we can build into their plans the ability to do either revenue sharing, which means that even before the plan is retired, they start kicking back some revenue to us, or that they have to retire the plan at the same year that they said they would, so that it wouldn't linger on and on. For any of you that might have monitored the urban renewal plan in the Clackamas Town Center area, one of the frustrations that the overlapping taxing districts experienced was that they were not paying off the debt. So their 30-year plan started to become a 35-year plan, and there wasn't really an end in sight. And meanwhile, the overlapping taxing districts, including Clackamas Fire, you know, had to add infrastructure to serve that area. So that's something that now, within the Tigard plan, within the Tualatin plan, and within the Newburgh plan that you'll hear about today, we actually captured that in the plan language, that the plan had to end and that we would have to start getting the regular tax revenues on that entire amount at the year the plan was scheduled to end. So there are things that we're trying to do just to safeguard, you know, the interests of our taxpayers. All right, so this is a whole bunch of numbers, and thank you to CFO Collier who helped inform this. But I heard from all of you during our discussion with the Sherwood City proposal for their urban renewal plan that you wanted to have a better idea of how all the urban renewal plans would be impacting us over the next 30 to 35 years. So what you see in front of you, and in a second I'll show you a picture of a graph that's a little bit easier to see, but you see each of the plans and the amount of revenue that we'll forego each year. And then you'll see when those plans are scheduled to retire. So starting with the column on the left, the Wilsonville City Center plan, this next year we'll be expected to forego $140,645 in revenue. And then you see as that goes down through 2042, what our foregone revenue will be. Same goes for all of the other plans. And on the far right, you will see the total amount that we will forego in revenue per year. In 2022, that will be just over $1.8 million. And then as we go down, sorry, I'm shifting my screen here so I can see it. In 2056, it shows a net positive of $1.18 million, and that is based on the revenue sharing that we have negotiated with partners. And that's actually a very, very modest amount. It's expected with the Newburgh and the Tualatin plan that we will likely see some revenue sharing as well. It's just a little bit too early for the financial analysts to project that. And statutorily, they're not required to, just based on their plans. But it is, you know, over a large amount of time, it is it's a pretty big number. But what most of our economic and community development partners will say is when the plan areas return to the tax rolls, that amount of valuation will be significantly more than it would be in the absence of the urban renewal investments. So that's another thing that we monitor, is to see, okay, how is the value growing in each of the plan area? Are they getting their projects done on time? Is the increment growing at a faster rate compared to other areas in the city? And you might remember a presentation from the city of Tigard where they had demonstrated that city center area was definitely outperforming the other assessed value areas outside of the urban renewal plan. So as we start to have a discussion about your policy, one of the key things to remember is that your policy reflects that where you have as a body supported economic and community development funding structure that does prove to increase valuation over time. So a lot of that depends on how the plans are managed. And I will say that for most of the plans in our service area, they are spending a good amount of staff time, dedicated staff time to managing those plans. So next I will show you, this is the same data that you just saw in that big monster spreadsheet, but just shows you graphically kind of the peak that we would expect from foregone revenue will occur in about 2040. And then it drops down as plans retire. This graph and that former spreadsheet, they do contemplate Newburgh's plan being approved, but some city charters require a vote by their residents to also approve plans. That's the case for Beaverton. That's also the case for Newburgh. So once Newburgh gets through their current process of informing everyone, once their urban renewal agency, also their city council, if they choose to approve the plan, it still has to go to a vote of the people. And the way that the Oregon law works around urban renewal is it's the city's discretion whether or not they require a vote of the people as well as the county. That is something that is established via their charters. All right, so in advance of this meeting, you saw the whole policy that's depicted for urban renewal and tax increment financing, which is in section 1.15 of your policy. I teased out kind of the most salient points of that. And so I know you've all seen this, but I wanted to just have a refresh of it. Basically that, you know, your policy says that you do want to support your municipal partners' efforts to create jobs and promote economic development. Your collective feeling that properly constructed plans can attract private investment and alleviate blight, and that they can ultimately benefit all public service providers. Part of your policy does generally oppose plan amendments which seek to increase maximum indebtedness. However, if a plan amendment or the use of TIF funding is properly focused and is essential, basically, in the case of a plan amendment to ensuring that all those plan goals are achieved, that you might support it or that you might choose to oppose it if it's funding plan amenities which are not proven to encourage private investment, or if the operational impact to us is so significant that it's problematic for us based on both that operational impact as well as the foregone revenue. Couple more things before we go into discussion. I've already mentioned some of these things, but as mentioned, we participate on every single advisory council, which includes both in the formation of an urban renewal plan and in the maintenance. So for example, Chief Kennedy serves on Beaverton Urban Renewal's Citizens Advisory Council that just kind of monitors, are they doing everything that they're saying they're going to do? And I represent the fire chief and the fire district on six other different councils and advisory boards. And so for the case of a new plan, we want to make sure that it aligns with good economic and community development practice and that it aligns with your policy. We look at all the things with the plan boundary, the project list, how they're funding it, making sure that they have other funding in addition to tax increment finance, that their financial analysis makes sense. Sometimes we will have input because they will enlist professionals that do financial forecasting to model different scenarios. Some might be really conservative, anticipating that the market isn't going to go, you know, perform well. Some of them might be really aggressive where they anticipate 7, 8, 9% evaluation growth each year. And so the committees, including TVF&R members, we will contribute to say if we think they're being too aggressive or too conservative. And that will be part of what informs the growth scenario that they ultimately adopt. And then they, we always ask the critical question that will those projects within an urban renewal plan spur economic development that wouldn't otherwise occur? And will it alleviate blight? And will it increase assessed valuation more than it would if there wasn't that government intervention? And then we look at the economic and operational impacts to TVF&R. So I'll cite the Tigard City Center plan, who they recently had an amendment to extend the time that that plan will have to get all their projects done. We have a fire station located near downtown. We haven't seen a significant increase in call volume within the area of the urban renewal plan. We're well positioned to provide service to the area. You know, therefore, it does not have a significant operational impact to the fire district. So, so those are all the things that we are looking out for on your behalf. We try to have conversations with our partners at the staff level long before you have to see anything to let them know about your policy and to try to conform to that policy. In many, many cases, we have influenced plans to the point that they don't have projects in them that they originally talked about having. With the most recent case with Sherwood, we did have conversations to let them know about, you know, concerns with the public works building, and they wanted to move forward, which is totally their prerogative. But they also had within the original plan proposal for Sherwood a complete remodel of their YMCA building. And it wasn't exclusively TVF&R, specifically me. There were other members of that committee that said, oh, we don't necessarily think that that's going to be helpful to the business communities that are either already here or want to be here. So they did scrap that project. And then lastly, I wanted to let you know that the fire chief, of course, not to speak on his behalf, but he's indicated this to us, and we resource this at our level, that we will continue to be on every single one of the committees. We will continue to monitor things so that you have a good sense of what might lie ahead for us. The recommendation that I have at the staff level is really to maintain your current board policy. The conversations we've had over the last 7 years and the four times that we've specifically looked at that board policy, we do believe that it provides a good framework for the decision making that has to occur at your level. And it's not so specific or constraining that it would be kind of a problem to represent when we're doing all the work at the staff level. And we'll continue to monitor any proposed legislation or any legislative changes that might change the landscape for overlapping taxing districts. So I've done a whole bunch of talking now. So this is where I would invite any comments from other staff, or just invite the board to talk about the policy and answer any questions that you might have.
Thank you, Cassandra. It's very informative. Any board members have questions first? Anything that remains a little foggy? Well, you must have done a really great presentation, because everybody's perfectly clear on urban renewal. Well, I can kind of launch it off. I think we're having this work session really kind of on the heels of the Sherwood URA that we voted against, and that created some angst, I think, with some of our partners, and even maybe a little bit within our board. So. I thought it was important that we all understand urban renewal as well as we can, knowing that we're never going to understand as well as you do. You're enmeshed in the middle of it all the time. But and then one concern, not concern, but I guess thought I had, is that with a growing amount of frozen assessed valuation, frozen tax base, I mean, obviously our costs and our expenses go up every year. So we have to fund those increases in costs somehow. And if we're not doing it through increasing tax, you know, assessed valuation, we're doing it largely through a local option levy, I think. And you know, it's kind of my napkin math. I think about 5 cents of our local option levy is in place to replace the deferred taxes from urban renewal. And maybe that's okay, maybe it's not, but I think we need to understand when we look at urban renewal, what the effect of that is in funding the district. And so really that's, you know, my interest in having this conversation today.
I absolutely agree about being concerned about the both the growth in plans and the types of plans. You know, we've definitely seen a resurgence of plans, as you've seen just by virtue of visits from our partners. And so that's one of the things that I communicate with both with the cities, and they nearly all of them employ the same consultant. So we have a lot of conversations about that as well. And I think Tualatin is an example. They are working right now on a preliminary plan, and it's a lot more modest than they had originally contemplated because they were concerned about the impact to the overlapping taxing districts. So I definitely think those are appropriate concerns, and that's what we try to champion on your behalf and on, you know, on behalf of the people that pay taxes to everybody.
And have the plans been creeping longer too? It seems like they have been. Seems like they kind of started off as 20 or 25 year plans, and now we're seeing 40 and 50 year plans.
Yeah, most of our plans are in the 25 to 35 year range, and you're absolutely right. They used to do shorter plans. And the challenge with that is it takes a long time to build up enough increment to actually fund projects. And so, so that's even a little bit of a line that we have to walk when we're talking with them about revenue sharing, is not wanting to potentially delay how long it takes for them to have the money to do the project so they can retire the plan. And so developers can come in and everyone can flourish. So that's really a consequence of how long it takes for the increment to build for them to actually do meaningful infrastructure improvements that are needed. But we do, that's one of the reasons also why I mentioned that we have requested building in those kind of the drop dead dates, as in, you know, you will retire the plan when it was slated to retire, so that it just doesn't keep creeping on and creeping on and creeping on, because Chief Weiss won't be here and staff won't be here in 30 years necessarily to make sure that that happens. And that's kind of a safeguard on behalf of, you know, future leaders of the district.
I think Chief Weiss is going to be here for 30 years though, so we're okay there. Isn't that right, Chief? Hey, Clark had a question on chat. Clark, you just want to ask the question?
Sure. I may have missed it when you were talking about Clackamas Town Center. Does the plan period get extended if refunding bonds are issued?
It can. It depends on their overall debt. So, but within the law that exists, if they are going to have to increase it for a certain amount of time based on a certain amount of debt, they have to come to the overlapping taxing districts.
Okay.
Well, so that's not a hard stop necessarily, retirement. It just,
how would they normally take
care of the rest of their debt through a bond?
They'll either repay it with increment. Sometimes they'll borrow from themselves. So sometimes the city will borrow from their general fund and then they'll repay it over time with interest. So there's some tricky little ways that they do that, but ultimately it used to be that a plan couldn't end until all the debt was paid. And then they could maybe end part of the plan, but not all of the plan. They could keep a certain area of the base frozen and the plan alive until they pay off that debt. Usually that's based on pressure from the overlapping taxing districts. But if for these newer plans that I've been participating and representing the district on, I'm actually asking it to be in their plan language, which is a little more stringent than the ORS, to have them end when they're supposed to end or to come to us, regardless of how much of the plan area or how much debt exists, just as a little bit of an insurance policy to protect our interests.
Okay. Thank you. So we could probably bifurcate this conversation into the policy first and talk about the policy itself. And if there's anybody who has a lot of energy on changing the policy, I know staff recommend that recommendation is the current policy is probably acceptable. It's okay going forward, but I'd like to hear from the other board members in that regard. Oh, you guys are awful shy today.
Bob should comment on that. He's the one who brought this meeting together.
So, hey, don't blame Blackmore. Sorry, I was on mute. Okay. I think the way our policy was originally arrived at bears merit. It's not so constricting that it doesn't allow us to be flexible and to acknowledge the changing times that we live in. And these changing times dictate how we do business. Do cities take advantage of urban renewal knowing that as demand increases for TVF&R, that we will go to the voters with our local option levy, and the cities know that the voters will support us. And likewise with the local school district. The cities are in my view, the cities are taking unfair advantage of their own citizens because they know where their weaknesses are. They will always support fire districts. They will almost always support the schools. And that's because we're a fairly progressive area of the state. Is that right for the cities to do that? Well, I guess it's right as long as they get away with it. Nobody has really called them on the carpet. I'll go back to Beaverton and the Round, which was started over 20 years ago. And the city planners and the promoters were so optimistic. And the Round went bankrupt. And the only entity that could bail them out was the city of Beaverton. If you go over to the Round now, the majority of property owners in the Round area, as it is right now, are Washington County and the city of Beaverton. They've got a Hyatt Hotel, they've got some condos, and they've got a parking structure. It has not invited the investment that they sold the community on. City of Tigard is following the same game plan. City of Tigard is the largest single landowner of property that needs to be redeveloped in the downtown core area. And they've only had one major interest, and that's Rosteria or whatever the company's called. And they're going to be building on city property with a single store. The first story is going to be industrial commercial for their own business, and the top four stories will be condos. Only 22 parking spaces. That alone is going to force the city to build a parking structure.
parking structure is going to be approximately a quarter mile away. The other large development in downtown Tigard is the Atwell condominium project. Majority owner and developer, once again, is the city of Tigard. They did not get any developer with deep pockets to come in. The city of Tualatin has had an urban rural district off of 124th for over 30 years now. And of the entire area of acreage, less than 35% has been developed. And this is in spite of the fact that they put in the streets, the utilities, the sidewalks, signaling for intersections where they anticipated traffic problems. Development is coming very, very slowly, because in almost every instance, developers are playing an ace card that they have up their sleeve. These communities are so thirsty for a developer that they're willing to give further concessions to a developer after the fact of the heavy investment they've already made. I have yet to see an urban renewal plan that has actually returned to the community anywhere near the investment that it was promised at the start. City of Sherwood, they misled the voters on their original urban renewal, and they built their new library, they built their cultural center, and a few other things. In the downtown core area of Sherwood, there has been little or no development. I believe there's been two condo buildings put up. And once again, the city stepped forward and further subsidized those developments. It's my estimation that this is a net loss for all taxing entities and all communities involved in urban renewal. That's why I would like to see our policy as stated not change. I think we need to look at whatever is being proposed by a community, and we need to start asking some really serious questions, and we need to start setting up roadblocks when they want to go beyond 25 or 30 years and saying, no, that's not acceptable. And the reason I say that is because history shows not a one of these has given anywhere near the return promised. Thank you for that time.
Well, thanks, Bob. You covered a lot of ground right there. You said you'd like to maintain the current board policy, but I think you also said something about maximum terms, 25 to 30 years. Is that, I don't think that, does the policy currently have that limit? I don't think it does it?
It doesn't.
I don't believe so. But if you go back about 40 years when Portland, Oregon initiated urban renewal, well, it's more than 40 years, there was a proposal to the state of Oregon that these would never last more than 25 years. City of Portland has, I believe, at least 7 urban renewal areas major status. Some of them are as much as 60 plus years old. To my knowledge, the city of Portland has never closed out an urban renewal area. And other people are following this game plan. It's how to legally use other people's money.
Okay, any questions or follow-up with Bob?
Gordy, I'd like to segue off what Bob was saying too, because I happen to be talking to someone who has 30 acres right across from the new Beaverton School District High School over there off of Roy Rogers and Scholes there. Was telling me he was notified that they're going to be moving his property from urban reserve to urban growth, you know, boundary. And so there's going to be a lot of development going on, but at the same time is lumber is going up. And this is what Bob was talking about, where they don't follow through or something happens and so on and so forth. Just think about this. And Bob, since you're in the remodeling industry here, you could pipe in on the, you know, on this too, is that just remember about a year ago, you could buy 3/4-inch plywood, a 4x8 sheet for around $40. And now it's going for around $94, $95. Lumber is really going up now. So we don't know if they could afford to do the building or doing the construction, but I have to agree with what Bob was saying. We have to be real cognizant and real careful about these things now, that they do follow through or have an end game or and finished product on everything. That's all I got to say.
If I may chime in on what Corey just said, starting about 2 weeks ago, there was a noticeable drop at the broker level of dimensional lumber. And the prices have actually dropped about 40% at their level. The normal contractor and the homeowner who goes into Home Depot or Lowe's, they're going to continue to see the same prices that have been in effect for a long time, which are approximately 300% more than what those prices were a year and a half ago. So a lot of people are taking advantage. If you were to draw a circle around the Portland metro area and go out approximately 60 miles, there are literally thousands of rail cars full of dimensional lumber that is owned by brokers. And they're waiting for the opportunity to jump the price again and take advantage of that 40% discount. They're not allowing the product to hit the market.
Okay. Justin, Clark, anything?
Well, based on Bob's last example, it's good to know that the tactics of John D. Rockefeller and Standard Oil are still alive and well today.
Yes, they are.
Okay. Now, I'll just say very quickly, I'm happy with the policy we have. I think it provides the flexibility that we need to apply it to specific situations as they come up. And I don't particularly want any more specificity to it. I'd rather just leave it where it is, where it allows us to apply criteria and go from there. So I don't see a reason to change. Thank you.
Justin.
I agree with Clark.
You're on mute, I think, if you're still going.
I agree with what Clark was saying. And I wanted to thank Chief Olven and CFO Collier. The spreadsheet that showed all of the existing and proposed URAs, I think was very helpful. The actual bottom line impact to the organization, that's what I had been looking for. And that allows us, I think, to make a more informed decision as these come up.
Yeah. So I think we have consensus, unless somebody wants to change that. I think we have consensus to leave the policy as it is. And I'd like to thank Cassandra, at least, you know, for my own personal work information here. I've learned a lot more basically from the conversation we had on the phone and then from this presentation. So I understand it a lot better. And, you know, I do have kind of a concern, I think, if our district is, if all of our district taxpayers are subsidizing a part of our district, a city, with whatever we do. I know we can't totally escape that in all regards, but I think in some cases we will. But understanding exactly what we're doing, so this isn't a, you know, kind of a secret sort of a process that cities use to dupe their citizens or whatever Bob talked about it. It's good to understand so that we can make an informed decision when we're presented with more and more of these. So I've kind of glossed through Newburgh's, and we'll be interested to see their proposal here in about 38 minutes. But if there's no need to change the policy, and with the, at least from my perspective, better information, I'm more informed about urban renewal now than I've been before. So I think this workshop has accomplished a good bit for me anyway.
Mr. President,
hey, Bob.
If I may, when you go back to the chart that CFO Collier put together for us, I want to go back one step further. I want to thank Chief Alvin for her in-depth report. Obviously, she's been involved in this for a very long time, and she has learned from a lot of these communities the different tactics they're going to use, and she has been very adept at tiptoeing on the tightrope to maintain a positive relationship with these communities, and I'm very thankful for that. What troubles me the most is looking at the chart, bottom right-hand corner, we're at almost $93 million. And that's just for TVF&R. If the citizens of our area that we serve knew what the total was, if you're looking at the schools, if you're looking at the county, if you're looking at clean water services, if you're looking at PCC, they may be absolutely astounded and shocked at what the grand total is. And some of those people might become a little more curious as to what's really going on with your urban renewal dollars. This is one area that no city has ever addressed in a public forum as to what the total obligation is for all these other entities. And in a way, it's a additional indebtedness to the communities that we all serve. And I'm kind of gonna throw some rocks at the media for never following up on this and giving the communities a full and comprehensive report. Knowledge can be a wonderful thing, and people are being denied a proper education in this regard. Other than that, I fully support our existing policy, and I really appreciate this workshop. So I want to thank all who were involved.
Thanks, Bob.
President Lauer, can I give a little context?
Yeah, go ahead, Tim.
Okay. So that chart shows about 93 million roughly over the next 35 years. Over that same time period, we're going to receive as TVF&R north of $5 billion, right? So it is a very small piece. And when we look at it, and not to try to muddy it too much, but when we look at it, right, well, the cities have urban renewals, we have local options. So the city's urban renewal will impact our permanent rate. When we do a levy or increase that levy then impacts everybody else's levies. So it's yep. More of a context of it's the way the system is kind of designed, where we all kind of try to get the funding and do the best that we can, I guess, with it. So I guess that's what I'd like to remember. And again, that's 93 million in well over $5 billion we will collect during that same time period. So that's all I wanted to say.
Bob Blackmore.
Randy, can you hear me?
Yes.
I just wanted to comment on the form of the policy at this point. I don't believe it's been updated for the 2018 modifications. And the one particular modification is the one with regard to public buildings and the vote that you did, for example, in Sherwood. So I think there ought to be an addition to that to recognize that vote and need to weigh in that scenario. So I'd like to work with Cassandra just to make sure we've updated it for the 2018 changes.
We did do an update in 2019, and I did work in the public buildings and other infrastructure, or that was in there, but I made sure that it was in our policy. So I think it still does honor the spirit of the legislative updates from then.
Okay.
But we can look at it together offline. But I that was one of the things I always go through and analyze ORS 457 as well as any legislative updates to 457 and look at it through the lens of our policy to make sure that there are, you know, that there isn't anything that's unlawful in our policy, as well as to mirror the furthest extent that we have possible to weigh in on plans.
So Cassandra, what I was looking at in particular was 090893A. I didn't see a reference in there to that. And so, but we can talk offline and see what you think.
That sounds great.
Yeah, I think if there is a need to update the policy, we'll understand what it's about. So you could just bring it forward later if you need to.
President Lauer,
go ahead.
Since Bob brought it up, could he give the board a really short synopsis of what that regulation that he just alluded to, what that refers to?
In short, it's the reference to when the proposals made to include public buildings within the jurisdiction and you need a 3/4 of vote to approve that. And that's what you did in Sherwood. For example, they came to you because they were including public buildings within the urban renewal area and in tax increment financing. And they had to go to the top 4 other public entities that are affected and get concurrence from 3 out of those 4.
Okay, so that's House Bill 2174 then in 18. That's up on the screen.
Okay. Is there any interest amongst the rest of the board members to not to set this in stone, but to make a recommendation to further urban renewal agencies that might be contemplated, that they, since we're all partners, that they seriously look at the 20 to 30 year plan rather than 30 to 50 year plans? Is there any interest in that?
Adding that to the policy is what you're saying, Bob?
Yeah, it just seems like these things keep growing and growing. And I don't know what the limit would be.
Can I jump in, President Lauer?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. I would just say I completely hear what Director Weifels is saying. And I think, again, when you put a hard and fast number on something in policy, then it doesn't allow for any adaptation that you might have. Somebody comes up with a new idea, a great idea, a wonderful idea, but the plan at the end of the day says 28 years or 30 years, and then you all say no. I think that with the information you've given us today and the things that are kind of important to you, it actually helps Chief Olvin and staff when we're participating in these urban renewal agencies to help guide that in that direction. So if they decide that they want to go beyond, say, 20, 25 years, staff can certainly engage and say, okay, if you do that, that may be a concern for our board, depending on who the board makeup is at the time. And then they can address it early on rather than have something etched in stone in the policy. It's essentially, it's guidance towards staff when we're working with these different cities and their urban renewal plans.
Has anybody ever reached out to any of these agencies that when they want to extend, they say something like, okay, we'll go along with that, but the increment increase between years 0 and 10, we would like some of that to come our way.
So I'll weigh in on that, Director Weifel. So as I mentioned earlier, I have negotiated revenue sharing for our newer plans. And that's why you saw in that chart some positive numbers even before the plan expiration time. The real problem with getting increment or revenue sharing, I should say, earlier in the plan is because they're building such small amount of increment, they can't even fund projects. And we do articulate to them. In fact, some of them have shortened the duration of their plan or actually stricken projects when we express concerns about the duration of the plan in terms of their overall other things that they have in their SETI and valuation. And so we do express concerns about that, and they're very, very aware. They forego revenue as well as one of the overlapping taxing districts, the cities and the counties and the other partners do. So, so we do try to, we represent that on a regular basis, you know, at the staff level.
Good. Thank you. Thank you. That's very helpful.
So you're okay with it not being in the policy as long as it's being addressed right now anyway?
I'm fine with that. Okay. At this time, I'm fine with that.
Okay. So I think we're still good with the existing policy. It's, you know, I think this will help us going forward to that if we are not in favor of a urban renewal plan in the future. It's not going to come as a big surprise to our cities, our partners. And that was kind of, I think Sherwood might have been a little surprised.
I think a couple of their elected officials were a little surprised, but I do think staff kind of had a good idea that might be where you landed and you're based on your policy.
Okay. All right. Do we have anything else to discuss on with this work session? I think we have the opportunity, once we give Ashley time to stop and start everything up again, we can roll right into the board meeting the way she noticed it. But we have to change the agenda around a little bit because Newberg's going to join us at 3:00. Is that correct, Ashley?
I like to pipe in here a little bit. This is Gordy.
Hey, Gordy.
I just want to say also kind of talking a little bit about Sherwood, I just think that there was some take, but it could have been a little bit more give in my opinion. So moving on from there, I appreciate doing this workshop, and it's good for us to go through things, to talk things over, to review, and you know, to get us together to discuss things and see what direction we want to go. So I appreciate putting this thing together and doing this. That's all.
Thank you. I think it's incumbent on us to understand it because we're representing a lot of people who don't necessarily understand this very complicated process. So they're trusting us to act on their behalf, and that's what this workshop was all about, pretty much. Okay, anything else, or are we ready to adjourn and go into our regular meeting?
President Lauer. Ashley, yes, were we going to take a break? Is that what we were going to do?
If we could, a short break, that would be wonderful.
Okay.
In order to change things over, and then we can head into the budget hearing.
Yeah, budget hearing, right. Between this meeting and the budget meeting, can we have a quick second with Blackmore to have that discussion in between meetings? Okay.
So do we stay on this line, or do we get off and then come back on?
Everybody can stay on this line.
All right.
I'll just call Bob. I'll call him on his phone. One more thing I want to clarify, President Lauer, and I appreciate all your input because this helps guide staff in the direction and what information you need as these urban renewal presentations come forward to make sure that you're well informed. So I appreciate the conversation and the input and feedback. It will inform how we move forward. And then just to clarify, I love, live, and breathe TVF&R. But in case my wife is watching on YouTube, I won't be here 30 more years. I just want to make sure I clarified that for you, President Lauer. That's all I had.
I didn't think you'd let that one. just live. So,
well,
okay. So we need President, to then go
President
ahead.
Lauer, unlike the chief, I'll still be around 30 years from now to do these battles over urban renewal via tax increment financing. So, cradle to grave.
Okay. So I think now we can adjourn the workshop, and then we can decide how long we want the break to be, and then we will come back to the budget hearing, correct? Is that the plan? Okay, is there a motion to adjourn the board workshop?
So moved.
I'll second it. I didn't know if we had to have a motion to adjourn, so I'll second it. Let's go, Gordy.
Yeah, I think we called it to order. We do.
Okay, gotcha. Okay.
Got a motion and a second. All in favor of adjourning the workshops? Well, actually, Ashley, you probably need to poll us.
Yeah. Do a roll call.
President Lauer.
Yes.
Director Hovey. Yes. Director Dillingham.
Yes.
Director Balfour. He was stepping away for a moment. Director Weichels.
Got a consensus.
Yes.
Okay, we are adjourned. So what's your pleasure? Do you want to, I have 2021 and it is 2:51 p.m. So I'll just read the introduction. The purpose of the hearing is to listen to citizens' testimony on the budget as approved by the budget committee. The budget committee formally approved the budget on May 13th, 2021. The committee approved the operating tax levy set at $1.5252, local option tax levy of 45 cents, debt service levy of $9,861,372. The committee approved total expenditures of $174,860,406 as presented in the budget document. So that takes us to receive budget comments from citizens on the budget as approved by the budget committee. Have we received any written comments, or is there anyone who notified you they'd like to comment on it, Ashley?
President Lauer, we did not receive any public comment via email or phone.
Okay. I don't think there's no minimum time we need to keep the hearing open, is there, Bob?
Sorry, I had to turn on my mic. No, there's no minimum time.
Okay, so I'll just do one last call. If there's anyone on the live stream here who would like to comment, who hasn't expressed so to this point, you could do so now. Okay, hearing none. We're ready for a motion to adjourn the budget hearing.
Don't we have to pass the motion first, this is Gordy?
Well, I think this is just a hearing, isn't it?
Correct.
Yeah, and then we adopt during the meeting, right? So
right, okay. Right. This is just right. This is simply to get citizen comments.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Of which there was none, so we can have a motion to adjourn the budget hearing.
I'll just run one.
Okay, moved and seconded by Directors Leifel and Hovey's. Ashley, would you call the roll, please?
President Lauer?
Yes.
Director Hovey's?
Yes.
Director Dillingham?
Yes.
Director Balfour?
Yes.
Director Weichels?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, so now we're ready to call to order the regular session of the Tualatin Valley Board of Directors. It's been kind of a busy day so far, but we're not quite done. Again, it is the regular meeting of Tualatin Valley Fire and Rescue Board of Directors. The date is June 22nd, 2021, and the time is 2:54 p.m. We have a first order of business, the consent agenda. One item was moved to next month. So we just have two items, a regular board meeting minutes and the budget committee meeting minutes. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Motion by Director Dillingham.
Obviously, second.
Second by Director Hovies to approve the consent agenda. Ashley?
President Lauer?
Yes.
Director Hovies?
Yes.
Director Dillingham?
Yes.
Director Balfour?
Yes.
Director Whitefoles?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, consent agenda is approved. And on to recognition. We had quite a few this month, and a lot of it very laudatory regarding the COVID vaccination clinics, and really great feedback. So if you've had a chance to read that, if anyone has any comments on recognition. Well, it's just pretty clear to me that we've got a lot of trust and respect from the folks we serve, and the way that the chief and his staff handled the COVID vaccinations was exemplary. And we talked about that before, but it was recognized by quite a few of our citizens. So thanks again, chief and staff. Moving into citizen participation. Ashley, is there anyone who's expressed an interest to chat with us today?
I think Chief Weiss has something to add for this.
Yeah, thanks, Ashley. President Lauer, we actually have Yamhill County Commissioner Bershauer would like to do public comment. And this would be the time that normally we would do citizen participation or public comment. However, I think her comment is towards the Newburgh Urban Renewal presentation. So I guess it's up to you. She's in the waiting room right now, and it's up to you whether or not you would like that comment period now, or you'd like to wait until after the Newburgh presentation.
Oh, I'd ask Commissioner Bershauer, would you like to speak now, or you want to wait for that agenda item?
Okay. Is there a way to do that, Ashley?
So she's in the waiting room right now. So I can email her and ask her what her preference is.
Can we just admit her? And then
Yeah, let's just admit her, and I think we can go right into that. Well, we're waiting for Newburgh, right?
Yeah. Okay, I'll admit her now.
Presentation. I'm not sure, with only 4 minutes, I'm not sure we have time to cover any other agenda items before 3 o'clock. We could probably go through correspondence. Actually, I kind of got correspondence and recognition mixed up anyway, because the correspondence is what I was replying to earlier. Sorry about that.
That's all right. That's all right.
Well, if what I said before, I would say again now, if it wouldn't bore you.
I would love hearing it.
Commissioner Bershauer has joined us.
Okay. I think we covered correspondence. So let's, as soon as Cassandra, Chief, as soon as you're ready to kick off with the Newburgh Urban Renewal presentation. We're still 3 minutes early, but.
It's from them. I don't think they've joined us yet. Is that correct, Ashley?
That's correct.
But I'd like to say, sorry, Director Whitefoles.
President Lauer, I did receive a communication from a person that lives within a district. And if we're short on time, I can wait to read what they said at a later time during a meeting.
This it's your call. Time for that. Be a good time for that, Bob.
Okay. It's addressed to Tualatin Valley Fire and Rescue. I am deeply grateful to the paramedic team that answered my call on April 22nd of this year. I suffer from rapid heartbeat, and they were absolutely prepared to slow down my heart and to get me ready to be transferred to Meridian Park Emergency Room. I want to pay special thanks to the team that administered to me in my Summerfield apartment. Kurt Kudelka, Jason Arias, Russell Coe, and Jonathan Callahan. Since I was awake, I was impressed with their questions and their medical knowledge and the appreciation they administered to me to slow my heartbeat. They were not only medically capable, but they had tremendous bedside manners, which assured me a lot. Thanks again to the team. You are a credit to the paramedic profession and to Tualatin Valley Fire and Rescue. Mm-hmm. Although I do not know her name, I was thankful to your medical records employee who answered my phone call in order to send the April 22nd call records to my heart doctor at St. Vincent's. She had them in the mail to my doctor immediately. Again, a credit to your organization. Signed, Jack A. Vogel, Summerfield Senior Community. And in addition to that, he sent me a note. He says, Bob, I want to credit Ralph Waldo Emerson. You cannot do a kindness too soon because you never know how soon it will be too late. This man is in his 80s and he's been living with this heart problem for at least 35 years. And he called me personally last week when he told me he was sending this letter over to me. And he just went on and on about how professional and how courteous our people were. And I think once again, that's just one more example of how good our TVF and our people are.
Thank you, Bob. It looks that some of our Newburgh partners are with us now. So we'll just kick this to Cassandra to introduce folks and get started.
Okay, thank you again, President Lauer and members of the board. I am looking forward to hearing from the Economic and Community Development Director, Doug Rux. And I believe that Elaine Howard, the consultant that has helped to inform the plan and guide us through the process, is here as well. I did want to provide just a little bit of a recap from staff perspective on the process that Newburgh has undertaken over the last 2+ years that I have been aware of it. And I know you have heard a past presentation from them as well, but the area that their urban renewal plan is contemplating to improve has really kind of stagnated over the last decades. And the projects that they have in their plan, the boundary of the plan, and everything that they aim to improve as a result of the urban renewal plan and the tax increment financing seems very, very well thought out. They've accepted a lot of feedback from the committee, and it's been a great process to participate in. So I have evaluated their plan in terms of your policy, and there is nothing, though you will not be making a decision, and legally you can't say yay or nay about the plan, I will say that it does really align with the things that you expect to see from a policy perspective in an urban renewal plan. So with that, I would like to introduce Doug Rux.
Thank you, Cassandra. Thank you, directors and Chief Weiss. Good to see you all again. It's been a little over a year, I think it was before the pandemic, actually, last time we were in front of you. Ashley, can you all see my screen?
Not yet.
Okay, hold on. All right, can you see it now?
There it is.
Okay, good. Even an old dog can be taught a new trick every once in a while. Okay, so I have with me today Dan Weinheimer, our city manager, and Elaine Howard from Elaine Howard Consulting. She's our primary lead in working with the city of Newburgh and putting together this urban renewal plan and the accompanying report. We had our sub-consultants, which are listed at the bottom of your slide, Tiberius Solutions, JLA, Public Involvement, and DKS on the engineering side. So we're, Elaine and I are going to do a bit of a tag team on the presentation. I'm going to start, and then she will jump in towards the end. This is what I call setting the stage. And so Newburgh has been involved in evaluating our downtown area and our riverfront area for a considerable number of years. We actually did a downtown plan in 1986. It was kind of put on the shelf, and we did a riverfront plan which did not include the former mill site, and that was done in, back in 2000-2001. So in 2015, we initiated a process and started to put together an economic development strategy. And that was brought forward to the City Council in 2016 and was adopted. And that was the first time the community was providing input about the possibility of an urban renewal program to help revitalize blighted areas within the community. We then also worked on our tourism strategy as the gateway to wine country. We did not have such a strategy. So we worked with a consultant, put one together, and actually we were talking about the riverfront and the possibility for development down there. And we had what we call moonshots. Then we updated our transportation plan, our transportation system plan. And then we moved into our downtown improvement plan is what we called it at the time. And so that's kind of the, on your slide is the center graphic. And so it's a little over a 100 acre area. And the community had stepped up and we had a lot of public involvement and they were looking for a pedestrian oriented downtown area, revitalization opportunities. And we came up with 10 big ideas. Many of those were infrastructure related with First Street and Hancock Street. But then there were other elements about connections to neighborhoods and art and gateway features and building facade renovations and so forth. The following year in 2017, we moved forward and updated our water master plan. The following year, then we updated our wastewater plan. By the time we got to 2019, we engaged in a community visioning program. First time the community had ever done one community-wide. There had been different government organizations who had done some visioning work. So we got a lot of really great input out of that. And again, one of the things that came out from the community input was the possibility of an urban renewal program. We then moved on to the riverfront master plan. So with the coming of the bypass, which cut through the middle of the old riverfront master plan, and with the closure of the mill and the pending sale that would eventually occur for that site, we moved forward and engaged in what's on the top right of your screen in an area a little over 400 acres and re-envisioned what the community wanted for its riverfront area. Predominantly, they were looking at parks, trails, and open space, but they were also looking at economic prosperity by redevelopment of the mill site, having some high-density residential housing, and also some commercial mixed use, so ground floor retail and housing above, and then some additional infill development. So kind of the north boundary of the riverfront was 9th Street, the east boundary is Winooski, and then it goes over to Chehalem Creek. So we got that one approved, and then we moved into our housing needs analysis to have a better understanding about what our housing needs were going to be over the next 20 years, and we got that completed. We went back in 2020, updated our economic development strategy. A lot of that was focused on the COVID-19 issues, and with the five pillars we had in there, what did all of the city and all of its partners need to focus on as we were moving through that global situation? We updated our housing needs analysis, again, based upon new population numbers. Then we moved in and did an economic opportunities analysis to better understand what our employment opportunities were in the coming 20 years. And so this goes out to 2040. We were also then working on our urban renewal feasibility study. As we had heard and I'd mentioned previously, it kept coming up in these community outreach efforts and these plans, urban renewal is a possible tool to help address areas in the downtown and the riverfront. We moved into the implementation of the riverfront regulations. We got that completed in 2020. And then we had to move through and update all of our infrastructure plans again for the riverfront area. And so last night, the council finished the final one of those, the stormwater. So we've updated our transportation, water, wastewater, and stormwater master plans. And we are here today with the urban renewal plan proposal. The graphic is on the far right of the screen is actually one that comes from the Oregon Economic Development Association, identifying there are over 130 urban renewal districts around the state of Oregon in both urban and rural environments. So I mentioned that feasibility study. So we started that in January of 2020 and it ran through July of 2020. We had, at the time, was an 11-member Citizens Advisory Committee. They met six times to work through that feasibility. We did a lot of public outreach and engagement. We social media was a way to get out, given the pandemic. Where we could, we were making community presentations virtually. We went to our Wednesday market, which was open, and handed out information. Of course, then we had a fact sheet and webpage information. We were constantly briefing our planning commission and our city council, and we were informing our taxing districts as we were going through this process. So we were sharing information to the administrative heads of all of the taxing districts. So that led to adoption of the feasibility study by the city council in July of 2020. And so we have both a summary version, the executive summary version, and then we have the full body of that report. And that's available on our website. And we've shared that out into the community as well. The next step in this process was in August of 2020. We went forward to the Newburg City Council, and they adopted an ordinance establishing the Urban Renewal Agency. And in that ordinance, they declared that blighted conditions existed within the study area, which is about 600 acres. The primary issues of blight related to infrastructure deficiencies, transportation, sewer, water, and storm. And so as I mentioned, we've been updating all of those documents. So then we engaged in preparing the urban renewal plan and report. So we started this in October of 2020, and the committee met through May of 2021. In this situation, they met eight times. They had a big challenge in front of them. We had identified around $118 million of improvements in 2020 dollar values. And in the end, we had to winnow that list down to a little over $59 million. And so it took a number of meetings of the committee to work through that, different sets of options. And in the end, they came up with a list. We again went through the public engagement. We did not have the farmers market because we were in the winter time predominantly, but we did use our webpage and fact sheets and videos. And we did a series of videos. So when the feasibility study, and we couldn't get out in front of people, we had our consultant Elaine put together a series of videos that were 2 to 4 minutes in length to explain urban renewal. As we got to the plan and the report, we did another video with the assistance of JLA to help inform the public. And all that information was pushed out again over social media, and we've shared it at different engagement opportunities. As we did in the feasibility study, we continued to brief our planning commission and city council, and we continued to inform the administrative heads of the taxing districts of where we were at in that process, and shared information and as well as information on the meeting dates that were occurring. So the area, it's approximately 600 acres. It includes the downtown and the riverfront, and then it has two transportation corridor connections, which would be River Street and Blaine Street. The committee came up with a maximum indebtedness amount of $106.4 million. And the graphic, the committee chose to break this down into sub areas to better understand the relationship of infrastructure improvements to the different development areas. And so the purple, for example, is the primary mill site. So that would be for industrial. And I'll get into more detail on each of these sub areas. As we have talked with community members, we've always indicated that urban renewal does not increase your property taxes. So I'm going to go now into the different sub areas that were shown on that previous map. So sub area A is the purple, it's on the left of your screen. That's approximately 100 acres of land, and it's the former mill site. So if you've been out there, you'll see that it's quickly going down. They're intending, and their schedule is to have the mill site removed by about the end of September of 2021. So in this one, the infrastructure that was identified was improvements to Winooski Road, which is on the right-hand side of that drawing. And so when I talk about transportation improvements, I also am talking about the underground infrastructure that goes with that. There are sewer lines, water lines, and storm lines. There's an east-west road that's identified. through this area. That road may actually shift a little further to the south as the property owner moves through some different concept iterations for how they might redevelop that site. And at the bottom, the brown line is what we call the Bluff Road. And so that would be a transportation corridor that would go from River Street on the left and go out to Dog Ridge Road. So these are the way to move goods and workers in and out of that mill area. It's also, probably also important to note that Winooski is our freight route. It's one of our freight route roadways. There's a green line identified here, and this is an esplanade. So this comes out of our riverfront master plan. The community members identified that they wanted to have those view corridors looking down over the Willamette River and out over French Prairie. The graphic on your right is south of the bypass, and that's subarea B. And that goes from the mill site basically over to Chehalem Creek. Most of this area is identified in the future to be park and open space area. So there's already Rogers Landing that would be on the right-hand side. There's another property in between that's owned by the Baker family. And then Yamhill County owns about 37, 38 acres, which is a former landfill site. So the improvements that were identified here were on South River Street from the bypass going down to 14th, and then improvements on 14th Street as well. And again, that also includes the underground infrastructure components. The green line, you'll see the ones labeled Esplanade. So that's a continuation of that Esplanade. So it would go from a cul-de-sac turnaround on Waterfront Street all the way over to our waterline bridge over by our water treatment plant. We do have a bridge that crosses the Willamette River that carries one of our water transmission lines. There's also the Newburgh-Dundee Bypass Trail. And the green line that follows along South River Street on the north side of 14th Street is part of that bypass trail system. Subarea C and D. So the left is C. This is north of the bypass. And this area specifically is addressing wastewater infrastructure. And so the topography out here is relatively unique. And so that a lot of that subarea B that I just showed you actually will flow back to the west, go underneath the bypass and go into this pump station. And then that pump station will pump it to back to the east, back towards River Street where it can get to a gravity line. And this is done to accommodate, you know, additional housing for medium density, high density, that commercial mixed use component. The area D, which is on your right-hand side, this one identifies some additional transportation corridors. One of the things we identified in our riverfront master plan is that we needed three primary access ways to get in and out of the riverfront area. So on the left is Blaine Street. And so that roadway does not exist today. Blaine Street stops at 9th Street, which is up towards the top of the drawing. And so that would improve and build a new roadway parallel to the railroad tracks and come back and connect in with College Street. Then there would be a College Street improvement. And again, with the underground infrastructure, which would go from 9th down to 14th Street, it crosses a rail line. So there's also a requirement. We've talked with ODOT Rail and there's a new rail crossing. So the traffic arms and the boxes and the pre-signals and so forth would need to be done. That also has to be done on the River Street crossing of the railroad line. Subareas E and F. So E, the project was identified, is River Street. And so you'll see a theme of River Street improvements from 14th Street all the way up to 1st Street, which is Highway 99W. If any of you have driven down the roadway, the road is in need of improvement. It's not wide enough. It does not have bike lanes. It's got narrow sidewalks. It does not have ADA ramps, and it's got insufficient infrastructure underneath that roadway. And F is again a continuation of that same transportation corridor improvement connecting the downtown area with the riverfront area. Subarea G is Blaine Street. And so this goes from 9th up to 3rd Street. And the green area is a location for high density residential housing. So one of the big deficiencies that Newburgh has identified through our housing needs analysis is more multifamily development. And in this corridor, we have a waterline deficiency. Actually, we've got waterline deficiencies in our South Newburgh area. We did a separate study and an analysis. And we've got undersized water lines. We've got lines down there that are 2-inch, 4-inch, 6-inch in size, and we do not have the fire flow to build the multifamily housing. Then area H is the downtown area, and there's a lot going on here. So the brown line through the middle is First Street. And in our downtown plan, it identifies doing a road diet. So that's removing one travel lane in that roadway. There will be sections that will need to retain the three-lane cross section because of traffic volumes. But that's the wider sidewalks. And that allows the businesses to be able to move out onto that sidewalk to create that pedestrian-friendly environment. But it is an infrastructure component. All of the blue lines that you see, which predominantly run north-south, those are areas within the downtown that are identified for waterline deficiencies, inadequate sizes of pipe. So it's the oldest part of town. And those are also directly correlated to where we have redevelopment opportunities on vacant parcels or parcels that are, you know, only partially developed. The yellow line towards the bottom is along Second Street, and that goes from River Street to Grant Street. And there in our downtown plan, we identified getting more residential housing along Second Street. But the issue was to try to get that 3 or 4 story buildings is that we have the overhead power lines, we've got the telecommunication lines. And so in conversations with TVF&R staff is to be able to get that kind of structure height, all of that infrastructure needs to go down underground. Then you'll see 2 circles kind of in the center of the downtown area, and those are 2 new traffic signals. And those come out of our riverfront plan. So to have that Blaine Street corridor connection to go from Hancock all the way down to College Street, those volumes would require 2 new traffic signals. The next piece of the downtown is an intersection improvement at Hancock Street and College Street. And again, that's related to traffic volumes. That one we only identified partial funding, and other funding would have to be found from other sources. Then the last piece of the downtown area is 2 public parking lots. We've had conversations with our Chamber of Commerce and our downtown coalition and our businesses, and they've identified that they need a couple more public off-street parking lots in order to support the existing businesses and as that infill development occurs on those vacant lots in the downtown. So this where I'm going to turn it over to Elaine.
Thank you, Doug. So as we all know, the impact of urban renewal is on the overlapping taxing districts. The projected impact to TVF&R is that there will be projects in the area that will spur additional development, which will increase your tax revenue in the future. As Chief Oven said at the beginning, there is much undeveloped land in that area that can be put to a higher and better use, but to be able to do that, that infrastructure needs to be installed. Over the 30-year projection of timeframe for the urban renewal plan, the impact to TVF&R is approximately $14.7 million. As you know, that impact does not reduce your existing revenues. It just impacts future revenues on increased growth, both that 3% growth that happens as long as we aren't in a recession to all properties and any rehabilitation, major rehabilitation, or new construction. Next slide. This just shows that impact over time. So it starts out slowly in fiscal year end 2023, the projection off of projected new growth and increased assessed value is about $28,500. It grows over time so that in the 30th year, it is expected to be about $1.3 million. Obviously, these are estimates. They're predicated on a 6.5% assessed value growth within the area. Given the amount of vacant and undeveloped land within the area, we feel like that projection is warranted. Next slide. As part of the development of this plan, the city given input from the taxing jurisdictions and especially your representative. The city included a duration provision within the urban renewal plan that the plan will not exceed a 30-year timeframe. They also included a provision that the plan would be reviewed every 5 years to see how they are on track with the required consult and confer process with the taxing jurisdictions. That is in addition to the required annual report that every urban renewal area agency is supposed to do for every urban renewal area and transmit that report to the taxing districts. So that 5-year review would be a more cumulative review and a look at what projects, more of an action plan type of review, looking at what those projects might be in the next 5 years. Next slide.
And that
goes to the questions.
Thank you. I will turn it back over to Cassandra to see if any of the directors might have any questions.
I'll turn it back over to President Lauer. You're muted, President Lauer.
I have to use my cup for myself this time. Sorry about that. Any board members have questions or comments?
This is Director Hobbies.
Go ahead, Gordy.
I was going to ask Doug on this development. Is might be off track. If it is, he doesn't have to, he could, you know, sidestep it. But I was just kind of curious because I just read we're on the Willamette River there that the Marine Board's going to have no wakeboard in that area. I was kind of curious if this, not to put blame or, you know, drive a wedge in there or anything else, is this, was this predicated with this urban renewal or the city of Newburgh, or is this a totally different arena?
Director, I would say it's a different arena. You know, good. We got our master plan for our riverfront. We finished in September of 2019, and was post that a lot of the conversations were on the wakeboarding or no wake. Wakeboarding on the particular river. We've talked with the Oregon State Marine Board. When we were putting together the master plan, people had ideas, you know, about could we extend the dock and could we have a floating hotel or a floating restaurant and so forth. And so we talked with the State Marine Board and they indicated that, you know, there was a grant that was provided to Yamhill County to do the Rogers Landing improvements. That dock is not designed such for, you know, a floating hotel or a restaurant. They did share with us that it's one of the heavily used boat ramps on the Willamette River, especially above the Willamette Falls. So it does get quite a bit of use. And they shared with me is that, you know, they would like to see the paddle boards and kayaks and canoes and so forth kind of upriver from Newburgh going towards Salem, where you have the motorized boats that are kind of going downriver towards Willamette Falls from Newburgh.
Yep. Good. You helped me out to quash any rumors out there. They try to blame Newburgh. So,
this is one, Director, is you can see, you know, we don't have any improvements identified at Rogers Landing or anything of that. We focus, the committee, I think, did a very good strategic approach of identifying and working with what infrastructure is needed to leverage new economic development opportunities within Newburgh, both in the riverfront and the downtown area. Our modeling has projected we could get, you know, 1.2 to 1.5 million square feet, maybe a little more, on the mill site through redevelopment. But it takes that transportation, sewer, water, and storm systems to make that work. That could generate, again, on the modeling based off of our economic opportunities analysis, 300 to 400 jobs just on the mill site alone.
And at the same time, too, is there anything or any whispering or anything coming up on the, say, the west side of Newburgh in the ADAC area of potential development on down the road on that area?
There is a master plan up in the North Newburgh area called Springbrook Properties. It's 450 acres. There would be about 1,345 new residential homes constructed in that master plan. I can say that I'm having conversations with representatives of that property, trying to get that to move forward. It's been stuck. The plan got adopted just before the Great Recession. We got out of the Great Recession and then we went into a pandemic. And so we are having in earnest conversations with them about trying to get that moved forward.
Okay, thank you. That's all the questions I got. Thank you for the information.
Thank you, buddy. Other directors have questions, comments? Go ahead, Clark.
Well, I'm pretty excited about this plan. I think it looks great. And so I'm encouraged and hope that you're very successful at it. I don't have any particular questions. I don't know that I have any more comments. I would be interested in hearing comments from the county commission. I know we have Commissioner Bart here lined up to go.
Yeah, I know. Is this an appropriate time for public comment? Because we do have one interested party.
I think unless you had any other comment from the board, President.
Okay.
You can request that she make her comments now if you wish.
Okay, let's see if any other board members have Justin or Bob.
No comments. Thank you for the thorough presentation. It was very well put together.
Yeah, thank you. Bob, anything? Bob's on mute.
Okay, there I am. Okay, I do have a couple questions. I'll try to keep it short. Mr. Rux, or Don, the old mill site, how much river frontage do you think is on that site?
I have not specifically measured that. There's probably somewhere between a little over a quarter mile of river frontage along the industrial portion of the mill site.
Okay. That's what I was thinking, about a quarter mile to a third of a mile. Next door to that is the waste management transfer site. Has there been any discussion about moving that to another location to aid further development?
No, there has not been any discussions with waste management about relocating their transfer facility, which is further to the east on Winooski. It's down by Highway 219.
Right. Do you folks have any concerns that the major truck traffic going to that site might impact some development just to the west of it?
Well, actually, so that's a very interesting question. So if we go back to the Newburgh-Dundee bypass, in the final FEIS that was done for that and the record of decision, Winooski Road will actually be realigned and go south. So it will go from where, if you were standing and looking at waste management's facility now, and you see their storage yard, which is to the east of that, Winooski Road is going to go across that property and go to the south about 900 feet and then reconnect with Highway 99W across from the realigned Wilsonville Road that was done as part of phase one of the bypass. So that area will look different in the future. Waste management is actually not within Newburgh's urban growth boundary, and it's not within the city limits. It's in an identified urban reserve area that could be brought in the future into the urban growth boundary.
I would think the community would want that to move. I have a question about the Willamette River in the Rogers Landing area. Is the infamous Newburgh Pool, which is a depression in the river bottom that historically has been collecting pollutants from farm country, industrial uses along the river. And that level of pollution is still there, as best I recall. Any thoughts about getting that onto a Superfund site or something with the federal government to help clean that up?
In my time, director, with the city, that conversation has not come up.
Really? So you have no knowledge of that area called the Newburgh Pool?
I'm very aware of the Newburgh Pool from the falls all the way up to Newburgh, and I've heard the dialogue over the last 30 plus years.
Okay.
But in my time here, our city council has not had discussions specifically about pollutants or supposed pollutants within the Newburgh Pool.
Okay. And then if you head closer to the downtown area, where you were talking about the proposal to put the utilities underground. We had the famous spring break quake back in 93, I think it was. And that's when, lo and behold, we all found out that there was a semi-major fault line that runs through Newburgh in that area. And I would imagine you've had engineering people looking at that to see how you can protect those utilities.
Yes, we are aware of that fault line, the Newburgh fault line that runs through. And, you know, our current standards that all utilities go underground, all the overhead, all the power and all the telecommunications go underground. As dollars are available from different sources, we've also done undergrounding. So between our engineering department and our public works department, they are diligently working to manage all of our infrastructure and then coordinating with the other utility companies on their infrastructure.
Great. They're going to find some very interesting challenges there. This is probably the single oldest area in the Newburgh community. Is that correct?
The downtown area, you know, original settlement area. So, you know, pre-1889, we became a city in 1889. So there's a lot of old and undersized infrastructure in the downtown area. The mill site, you know, it was operated as a mill for over 110 years, started off as a sawmill and then converted into a paper mill. They were pretty well self-contained for infrastructure. And then their intake is down at Rogers Landing, and they were drafting water out for their industrial operation. And then they had their own lagoons for their wastewater treatment. And we're working with the current property owner about how those two lagoons may be repurposed for water quality facilities. And of course, that will require discussions with DEQ on what those processes and steps would be.
Does that mean that the former discharge pipes that used to go into the Willamette River, that those have been abandoned and plugged off and could never be used again?
They have not been plugged off. Right now, the only water that's going into the two lagoons is stormwater runoff or rainwater. And the water levels are such since they've closed the mill. So the mill was bought on October 1st, 2015. It was idled on October 15th of 2015 and closed in January of 2016. So there's been essentially, you know, no discharge from the industrial operation going into those ponds since early 2016. It's just been surface water and rainwater going in.
Has anybody monitored that water since the demolition started? Because there was a very high level of asbestos in that facility.
I would say we have shared with CDC that they need to coordinate with the Oregon Department of Environmental Quality as they went through their demolition process. And I've been informed that they've had those communications with DEQ.
Great. Thank you. Mr. President, I have one question for Elaine, if she's still available.
Sure, if Elaine's still on, go ahead, Bob.
Elaine, thank you for your presentation. I have one question. It refers to the 6.5% growth rate that you mentioned. Have you ever seen that kind of a growth rate in an urban renewal area in the last 20 years in our area?
I can't speak for all urban renewal areas. The thing that allowed us to go to that high of a growth rate in this area is the fact that you have so much land that will be developable. So you have just 100 acres in your downtown, and the remainder of that acreage is just the two streets that connect to the riverfront area and the riverfront area itself. The thing that can give you assurance about that growth rate, if you feel that it is too high, is that you do have the plan duration provision built within your plan. So if for some reason the urban renewal agency the area is not able to sustain that amount of growth, they will have to, the way the plan's written, they will have to go with the amount of growth that they actually get, and that will be the amount of money that they have to spend. The way the plan is written at this point, that duration provision keeps them from just extending the plan because they didn't reach that growth that's projected.
Right. What I have seen and learned of other URAs that are within the TVF&R service district is that they're below 2% on actual growth. People have been very optimistic with their numbers, and I hope that isn't the case with the Newburgh plan.
I hope not also, but I feel like the taxing districts are protected due to that duration provision.
Let's hope so. Thank you very much. I appreciate all your work.
Thank you.
Mr. President, those are all the questions I have at this time. That was a great presentation.
Thank you. Yeah, I'd echo that too. I think you did a great job of presenting it, and the overall concept you have is real heavy on infrastructure to drive that development. So I appreciate all the time and all the staff time and the citizens' participation you engaged. So thank you for all of that. Commissioner Bershauer, would you like to comment on the Newburgh plan?
Sure. Thank you, President Lauer and members of the board, as well as Chief Weiss and the other chiefs on today's. Thank you for squeezing me in here. Appreciate that, Ashley. So this came in front of our board last Thursday. And so my comments should not be new to Mr. Rux, nor to Dan or Elaine. These are questions that we asked last Thursday. I personally am opposed to this plan, and the indications from the majority of the Yamhill County commissioners are that we don't support the plan going forward. And there's many reasons why. I listened to your work session, and I appreciate the comments from Director, from Bob, about his concerns about the use of urban renewal. I've been watching urban renewal for many, many years, and urban renewal has become a tool used by government, in my opinion, to circumvent the input from the community. It's something that local government districts can use without the requirement of going to the people. And we've seen that across the state, notably in 2011 and 12, we saw it in Clackamas County, and it got so heated politically that it is now a requirement for a public vote in the county, Clackamas County, for any new or expansion of urban renewal in the unincorporated zones of the county. We saw this come through in Tualatin. I went back and did some research on TVF&R's stance with the Tualatin expansion and how heated that was. I would argue that the Tualatin expansion and that kind of fight led to eventually the implementation of term limits for the mayor and for the city councilor because of the public's feedback on that. I went back and looked at Sherwood and your concerns there. And ultimately, you know, I would agree with Bob in the sense that this tool is really just it provides developers handouts at taxpayers' expense. And from the county's perspective, this directly affects us because we have pieces of land and properties that are slated to be a part of this district. So we are now discussing whether or not we want to be a part of it or support it. And I would say, even based on conversations that happened today, that our inclination is to not support it. We feel that, and this is based on personal experience as well, that the city has other tools they can use to promote economic development. Their SDC fees are frankly the highest in the county when you factor in CPRD. I have literally watched developers leave public meetings because they were so frustrated about the SDC fees and how high they were. The permitting process, you know, we invested in, because we have a childcare desert in this county, we invested in a project called Project Oasis, and they wanted to set up their childcare facility in a certain part of the city, but it was so prohibitive to do so because of the SDC fees that they had to move. So this is a problem for the city of Newburgh. They know it's a problem, and yet they don't seem to be willing to do anything about it. The other option would be to just go out to the public and ask for a GO bond, a general obligation bond, and ask the public for permission to invest in some of these facilities, especially the waste treatment plant or the improvements to public accommodations via roads or sewer water infrastructure. You all know that I also served on the Newburgh Rural Fire Protection Board District as a director. We went through this process back in 17 and 18 about annexing into TVF&R. So for me, this is a personal issue. This is something that the taxpayers in Newburgh and the surrounding rural areas have recently decided to come on board and to pay a premium, really, for premium service. You know, they decided that they were going to pay more for coming into TVF&R and receiving that premium service. And now you're asking them to essentially agree to siphon off those dollars, considering that a large part of this district is existing infrastructure that is already generating property taxes. So you're asking those voters to siphon off that money that they recently agreed to and send it to developers. I think that's disingenuous at best. You know, I think that, and I'm not trying to put TVF&R on the spot, but I do feel that TVF&R and the board owes it to the city of Newburgh taxpayers as well as the rural district to say, hey, this is the reality of urban renewal. Do you agree with this or not? Because you guys just walked through this process with us in terms of annexing, and you trust us, you're paying us to do this, you agreed to do it, but do you agree with this process? So at the very least, I would hope that this board would come forward and say, we want to be good community partners, but we feel that this should go to the public for a vote. We want their buy-in because they just recently walked down this with us and they agreed to do it. And the reality of urban renewal is that there has to be replacement revenue. So TVF&R, whether they come back in the future with their local option levy or the school district comes back with a bond or whatever, there has to be replacement revenue. And so that's my ask of the board, is to support it, at the very least, a public vote.
Okay, thank you. And this, just to clarify, there's not currently a requirement for a public vote of Newburgh residents, correct?
Mr. Chair, that is correct. It's not in our charter to require a vote.
Okay. Had that been discussed by the groups developing this at all, or?
My recollection is we worked through the last year and a half with the Citizens Committee, an earnest discussion about should this go out to a vote or not was not part of those discussions. There is in statute a referendum process at the end of developing an urban renewal plan.
Okay. Thank you. Any board members have any other questions or comments? So I believe that our task is to see and hear your presentation. Go ahead, Bob.
Sorry, I keep getting up on muted. Maybe that's a good thing. I might extend some information that over 35 years ago, when the city of Tigard first headed down the path of urban renewal, they had some very, very lofty plans. And they were going to use the state statute that Don just referenced as their argument that they could just move forward since they were all elected officials. And lo and behold, a committee was formed in the Tigard area, and it was called the Right to Vote Committee. And they petitioned, and they were successful in getting a charter amendment for the city of Tigard that said, you have to go to the voters and allow them an opportunity when you're talking about this level of indebtedness. And other communities have kind of gone in that direction in other ways other than having an official vote. But it's my understanding that Tigard is the only city in our service area that requires a vote of the citizens. And I would think that would be a tremendous advantage to the city and the developers that they want to partner with to have such a vote and to make sure that their entire community, or at least a majority of their community, is on board with this. It just leads to more transparency as to what government is really doing. And I applaud the commissioner for speaking up, I would like to see this message taken back to the mayor and the city council by Don and Elaine, that perhaps they should take a look at being more open with their community as to how they want to invest their money. I rest my case.
Randy. Okay, thank you. Clark, go ahead.
You know, Bob, I'm going to disagree. That is not our message to send. This message, if there is discontent or dissent within the city itself, it's for city residents to bring that up using the referendum process, going to council meetings, doing whatever. I believe it's way beyond anything that this board is asked to do in terms of being a service provider to as many as 9 cities, 10 cities, whatever it turns out to be sending a message back as to how those folks should make local decisions. And I don't want to be any part of that. So we're not asked to make a decision today. This was an informational thing. I appreciate the comments that were received, but I think it's up to the city council, the urban renewal agency, whoever is part of that public process to bring something forward to try to determine what's in the best interest of their city and to make the best use of their land. So we should stay out of that. And I'll oppose any effort to send a message back. It's not our message to send. Thank you.
Thank you, Clark. Are there other comments?
Okay, I agree with Clark. That was not my intent. I was just trying to make a reference to a historical decision that was made by one of the communities that is part of TVF&R. And yes, it is not up to us to try to dictate in any way to any city how they conduct their business.
Right. Yeah, and we just spent, we spent quite a bit of time going through our board policy on urban renewal, and it's really silent on that. And, you know, I appreciate the comments. There's a lot of passion about urban renewal going both ways. But yeah, I think we haven't been elected to represent Sherwood as a city. So I don't know. That's a good thing we don't have to make a decision today. But I think that the next step is in July, there'll be a resolution before us. So isn't that the process?
Not Sherwood, it's Newbert.
What did I say?
Ed Sherwood.
I'm sorry.
You're fine. I just wanted to make sure the record, because we are recorded. So that's all.
President Lauer, there will not be a resolution related to the Newburgh Urban Renewal Plan.
Okay.
So the only requirement is that they present the information to us, and that's exactly what's occurring now, but we don't have any resolution.
So we do not have to concur or not concur because there's no public construction, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
And if I may, is in the confer process, by statute, you have 45 days. And so we sent the chief and all of the taxing districts a certified mail notice and email on June 9th, which started that 45-day clock. You have until July 26th to provide any written comments back to the city for the city council to consider in their identified public hearing to be held on this topic for August 2nd of 2021.
Okay. Thank you for that, Doug. Okay, if there are no further questions or comments, I'd like to thank the Newbergh staff for the presentation again. Well done.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you for allowing us to give you your presentation, and have a good rest of the meeting.
Thank you.
This Director Hovey's thank you for your presentation. Appreciate it.
Take care. Okay, now we're on to our finance report. CFO Collier.
All right. Thank you, President Lauer, members of the board. I'm here to present the May finance report. The month of graphs you'll see here. A couple of things, the highlight that the revenue is above where we budgeted, and I'll talk about that in just a second. Currently, ending fund balance is a little lower than we had last year. However, we still have a couple of things to bill. So I believe that we are going to come in almost exactly where we budgeted to start. Materials and services are still tracking a little higher than normal. But again, most of that is because of the beginning of the year and the additional EMS COVID supplies. And then lastly, at the bottom, you'll see a big difference between last year and this year in the payroll for this month. And a big portion of that is really the vaccine branch overtime. And again, we gave our last shots at the beginning of June. So we should see that go down here in the next couple of months, or next couple of months that we report. So on to the actual finances. The big thing is we have received about $469,000 in vaccine revenue, and that is both from billing Washington County directly for the homebound, and then also our initial insurance billing. So we're still going through that process. And I believe that the estimate right now is about mid-July, we'll have all of the billings completed. And then whatever the delta is, we'll be going to OHA to seek reimbursement to make us whole in that area. And we have received the California payment for the Conflag. So they are the last outstanding payment with regards to Conflags. On the expense side, there's a couple of things that we're going to take care of in the budget amendment that is coming up here in a minute. But again, nothing outstated, and most of it, it has revenue associated with it, but I'll talk about that during the budget amendment. And with that, open it up to any questions on the report.
Thanks, Sam. Any questions? Hearing none, can move on to capital.
Capital projects report. Again, there's two ongoing projects. Actually, for the most part, we are closed out at the Logistics Service Center. We are still finishing up construction on 54, and that should be coming to conclusion shortly. And that's all on the capital projects dollars. I believe Chief Weiss will talk a little more about the actual projects themselves here in his report.
Okay, thank you.
I'll have on capital projects.
Okay, any questions? Okay, so we've gone through correspondence. So we have old business. We have a second reading of board policy section 3.
Good afternoon, Mr. President and members of the board. Board policy number 3, budget and finance, was presented for first reading at the May 25th board of directors meeting. At that time, no further revisions were suggested. None have been applied. The policy is now presented to you for second reading and board approval.
Okay, thank you. Is there a motion?
So move, Hubbies.
Moved by Director Hubbies.
Seconded
by Director Dillingham. Any discussion? Okay. Ashley, would you call the roll, please?
President Lauer.
Yes.
Director Hubbies.
Yes.
Director Dillingham.
Yes.
Director Balfour.
Yes.
Director Rifles.
Yes.
Okay. Motion passes. Ashley?
Board policy section 3, budget and finance, second reading.
All right, thank you. New business, we have some new business that you've kind of teed up for us, Tim.
All right, President Lauer, members of the board, before you is a resolution 2021-04 to approve the general fund budget transfers. And those cover the finance directorate, which had $30,000 in additional insurance premiums, as Ron Cutter talked about how insurance is up and it was above what our budgeted amount is. We also had a $76,500 payment for GEMT. What ended up happening is we budgeted for 1 year payment. We ended up having two. So we have a revenue offset of about $300,000 to this number. In the operations directorate, because of all the overtime with regards to COVID, et cetera, we're looking to transfer $500,000 to cover those overtime costs and operations. Again, this will be offset either through insurance and or OHA billings. Again, also the $100,000 increase on M&S, and that's for EMS supplies. Again, we will have seen a reimbursement for that. And then in the business directorate, we originally budgeted in the behavior health group, we originally budgeted a position. Bill King, of course, retired last June. We used a contractor for those services. So we are just moving the money from personnel services to M&S for a grand total of $852,500. And I am available for any questions.
Okay, questions from the board. No questions. Is there a motion then to approve this resolution? Don't everybody be shy now. We've got three of them to go through. Yep.
Director Hubbies.
Move for approval.
Yep.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Ashley, would you call the roll, please?
President Lauer.
Yes.
Director Hubbies.
Yes.
Director Dillingham?
Yes.
Director Balfour?
Yes.
Director Weifel?
Yes.
Okay, motion passes. Now we have resolution 2021-05.
Okay, so this resolution is the first of two resolutions to approve the 21-22 budget, and this one is to approve the appropriations of $174,860,406.
Is there a motion for this resolution?
So moved.
Moved by Director Dillingham.
Hovey's second.
Second by Director Hovey's.
Question.
Discussion?
Yeah, no discussion.
Okay. Would you poll the board, please, Ashley?
President Lauer.
Yes.
Director Hovey's.
Yes.
Director Dillingham.
Yes.
Director Balfour.
Yes.
Director Weifels.
Yes.
Resolution passes. We have one more, 2021-06.
And this, President Lauer, is the second of the two, and this is to approve the levy and categorize taxes for 21-22 year. And there you go. I'm open for any questions.
Okay. Is there a motion to approve this resolution?
I'll move to approve resolution 2021-06 as stated on the agenda bill.
Thank you. Moved by Director Balfour.
I'll second.
Second by Director Dillingham. Ashley, would you call the roll, please?
President Lauer.
Yes.
Director Hovey.
Yes.
Director Dillingham.
Yes.
Director Balfour.
Yes.
Director Weifels.
Yes.
Resolution passes. Good job, Tim. You got them all three of them.
Thank you so much. Appreciate that. And just want to shout out to my staff real quick with regards to the budget process and how well they did. So I appreciate all them. Thank you.
Okay, Chief's report. Chief.
Fantastic. Thank you. First up will be a capital projects update presented to you tonight by me. I get to do this one. So I know we don't normally do it, but Chief Habner had a loss in his family, so he is not here this evening. But first thing you'll see is the updated pictures for Station 54 there in Charbonneau. We were hopeful to have this station open by now. As the board is aware, there was a mold issue that the property owner had to work through. And then we were trying to work through the temporary apparatus shelter that will go outside this station. I believe the current delay has to do with materials, believe it or not. So we're trying to get the materials to erect the apparatus structure. I think we've completed all the processes with the city. So we're hopeful in July, and we'll give you an update at next month's meeting or before when we talk. The other thing I had on capital projects is the property station site location in rural Newburgh, which is located off of Dopp Road. We're in the process of land use approval. AKS is preparing the application, and then they will do estimates on the site work that is to be conducted. And then, of course, we'll work with Bob Blackmore to create the lease agreement with the air park there in rural Newburgh. So we're excited about both of these projects. And that concludes the capital projects report, unless there are questions for me.
This Director Hovey's clarification on that Newburgh, are you saying you're renting or you're going to buy it?
I think that is a lease agreement with the airpark is what that one would be. But I don't have all of the details on it yet. We're still in the very, very early stages of that site acquisition.
Well, I'll talk about it at our next chief's meeting. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Chief.
Next thing I have is the COVID-19 update. So not a ton of changes here at TVFR. Certainly the most important one is that there's been no reports of anybody under quarantine or COVID positive. We haven't had any of that since we've had the vaccinations. Our vaccination clinic has been dismantled after 71,522 injections that they had given, which is quite remarkable. I attended a Metro Chiefs conference meeting last week, and they talked a lot about vaccinations. And there were a few sites, Mesa, Arizona, I think another one back east, they were doing 2,000 to 3,000 a day. But beyond that, haven't heard very many others that were engaged to the level that we were with COVID vaccinations. So extremely grateful to staff across the board for participating in those vaccinations. And I think it was a great success and something certainly that we gave to the community, and we could also vaccinate our employees and our employees' families. So it was good all around. Internally, the COVID status for our operations will change July 1st. And we've already changed one thing based on OSHA standards, which is you're not required to wear a mask in a station, whether vaccinated or not. That's something that Oregon OSHA had pushed before. We weren't quite there yet. And once we exceeded that 78% vaccination rate, we thought that we could remove that requirement to always have a mask in a station. So we've done that. It's been probably 3 weeks now. And again, no additional COVID cases, nobody on the watch list. So we've been successful. And then I think we're just going to wait and see what the governor does, what the state does. And then we have to wait for what does OSHA tell us to do. So we're slowly going to creep back into a normal business operation, but we have some phases to work through before we actually get there. So that is what's on the COVID front. Unless there are questions specific to COVID, I would be happy to answer. I'm not seeing anybody move, so.
No, I think we all have a sense that we're getting really close, but we're not quite there.
Yeah. I completely agree. And then it's that lag, right? So there'll be a change and everybody will expect a change, but we're not quite there yet until we get that further guidance about stations. So,
right. And then OSHA repealing their rules, which they've indicated they're going to, but we don't know how long that's going to take.
Correct. Yep. We're facing the same thing I think you are. So,
yeah.
Okay. Next up is a legislative update, and I will give you Chief Hallman.
Thank you, Chief Weiss. Good afternoon, President Lauer, members of the board. And we are in the final week of the 2021 legislative session, which will close this Sunday. And of the most interest to the fire service are two remaining bills. House Bill 2927 will make the Oregon State Fire Marshal a standalone agency. Yesterday, this bill passed the House with a unanimous vote, and it's expected quickly to make its way through the Senate floor. It is a big victory for the Oregon Fire Service, and of special note, one of the chief sponsors of the bill is our own Representative Graber. Senate Bill 762 is the omnibus wildfire bill that we've talked about a couple times before. It's turning out to be much more challenging, especially these last 2 weeks, and we've seen it create a big divide among party lines. It was heard this afternoon by the full Senate Ways and Means Committee, and I'm happy to report it did just pass out. It was a close vote, again, by party line. But the good news is it's now on the way to the Senate floor for a vote. Speaking of wildfire, most of you probably already heard the news that for the first time ever, the Oregon State Fire Marshal has pre-positioned two task forces in Central Oregon for the forecasted red flag warnings and anticipated light event that's coming this week. Under this new program, during critical forecast models, the State Fire Marshal hopes to bolster local resources by pre-positioning outside task forces to help with initial attack and keep the fire small, thus preventing a conflagration. This past year, legislators approved funding for this program with the goal of preventing conflagrations, which all of you know come with a great cost to the state. The two task forces that deployed today were from Washington County and Marion County, and I'm proud to report that TVF&R resources made up the bulk of the Washington County task force. They'll be held over in Deschutes County for the next 72 hours, and if not needed, they will get to come back home. And with that, Mr. President, that's the legislative report.
Thank you.
This is Hobbies, Director Hobbies.
Go ahead, Gordy.
Yeah, first a comment. This situation with the having the State Fire Marshal's office go standalone is huge, because for years could never get it to separate because of the turfs, within organizations. And I'm not here to disparage anybody, but I think people know. But I think also what really helps out too, and I'm sure he had something to do with behind the scenes, with his experience and his knowledge coming from Florida, being the fire marshal there, is Les had said, hey, you guys need to stand alone because we did it here and where I came from, and it works very well. So I'm sure you did some, and if not, the inference is there. So thank you, Les, for doing it, because this is huge. And
it was a big team effort, Director, and there was a lot of people involved. Thank you for saying that, but trust me, there were a lot of people involved in this.
Yeah, well, your input, I'm sure, helped. Yes, you're right. There was, I'm aware of a lot of people getting involved in it, because this was a big, huge victory. And this is, you know, this is one of those deals, is like the saying goes, is, you know, it's worse than a sore loser is a sore winner. We're not going to be sore winners. This is an efficiency thing for the state of Oregon. It's going to work out real well for everybody. So, and we'll see a lot of good things come off of this. But yes, to all the people involved, thank you. And you too, Les. And also the other thing is that on the equipment, what pieces, just out of curiosity's sake for me, what pieces of equipment that are on the task force that Tualatin Valley sent to Deschutes?
Chief, you want that, or you want me to tell him?
I know Chief Rentress is there.
Yeah, I'm happy to speak to that. From Tualatin Valley, we sent two heavy brush units. Both of those units were staffed with three of our personnel. And we also sent a task force leader and a task force aide. The rest of the task force was filled out by the Hillsborough light brush rig, a Banks light brush rig, and a Banks water tender.
Great, thank you. And that's all I have. Thank you guys for the information, really appreciate it.
And I just can't emphasize enough, this is June.
Yeah, really. Hey, Chief Allman, was that Representative Evans' bill, or was it a carve out from that early bill he initiated?
So he was the forefather of that bill, and it wasn't just a state fire marshal. It also addressed emergency management. It was a little bit of an omnibus bill, but not too big. But yes, he helped start the conversation a few years back, and it's gotten to this point. And what he did was, as you all know, I work on the Governor's Fire Service Policy Council. He reached out to us last year and got us engaged. And I have to give Representative Graber a lot of credit. She got on board. She understood the importance of this, and she actually worked side by side with Representative Evans to get this thing going.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Next on the Chief's Report is 4th of July preparedness. It seems like just a year ago it was 4th of July, and here we are, 4th of July. So we will do some of the similar things that we've done in years past that we think have been successful. In terms of fireworks show, we've only had one public fireworks show planned, and that is the city of North Plains, which is up there, I believe, at Pumpkin Ridge Golf Course on that area. So that's the only public fireworks show that we have planned. Fireworks sales, approximately 80 fireworks sales locations have submitted to be permitted and will be inspected by deputy fire marshals starting in a couple of days, June 24th. We are assuming that with the lack of public displays, there might be an uptick in the purchasing of private fireworks for home displays. In terms of our response units, we'll do the same thing that we've done for the past several years, which is we'll send out crews during the day to drive through neighborhoods, have a presence, be seen before dark, and then hopefully people will make good decisions after dark when they do their own fireworks displays. Community awareness, we'll push out numerous fireworks safety messages to local news, social media, newsletters, newsletter outlets, and web posts in the coming week, and encouraging people to please be safe with fireworks. And that is all I had on 4th of July, unless there are any questions about that. Seeing none, we'll move on to Chief Fail contract extension. So as the board is aware, Chief Fail went out to Forest Grove to help manage Forest Grove Rural, Gaston and Cornelius, tongue-tied. And he's been there since first part of this year. They reached out to me and would like an extension for Chief Fail to remain there longer. And we have agreed to that. Certainly I checked with Chief Fail to make sure that he was okay with that and make sure that things were going well for him. which he agreed to. So he was out there a little bit longer. They did start their fire chief process, and he is working as part of that. He's also working to finish up budget and work with contract negotiations. So he certainly is serving a valuable role out there for them. And I think his growth and development continues to grow as he spends time out there. I'd be happy to answer any questions about Chief Fail's extension, if there are any. And then the last one that we've talked about, you know, several times in the last years is virtual board meetings as we do today. And I know a lot of it is because we've been constrained by what we're allowed to do. And thankfully, the board agreed that we try to follow the same mode of operation that the fire district is in. So when we had to shut down, the board agreed to that. We went virtual. Since that time, things are starting to slowly change, and the mode of operation is slowly starting to change. So staff has done some work and some recommendation of how we want to proceed into the future. Now, I know that I can't predict when we might be back in person and what that looks like, but we would recommend, and I would recommend, that we take the following year from July to June, and we evaluate kind of a hybrid process of virtual and in person. And whether that means that all the board is here in person and the public is virtual, or some of the board is here in person, some of the board is virtual, and the citizens can make comment in person at board meetings. We're not sure what that looks like. There's certainly some infrastructure that we'll have to work on, but we believe, as I think the board believes, that the transparency of having this online, having this on YouTube, is valuable and gives easy access, not just to the community that we serve, but also fire stations and our personnel. They can go back and view these board meetings as well, where they couldn't before. So I think there's both internal value and external value. We would recommend that we keep the meetings the same at 3 o'clock. Part of that has to do with staff workload and staff attendance. I think it's been a good time, but we will carve out meetings for when we've done traditional evening meetings for, say, a budget workshop, budget committee meeting, or other events as they come up. What we're hopeful for is that this year actually informs board policy moving forward. It'd be one thing to try and come up with one that you all like and approve of. It would be a lot easier if we slowly step in to normal operations. And what does that look like? What do we need to do? And let that write the policy. So that's what staff is recommending. I know that we've spoken with Bob Blackmore to make sure that we're following all rules that apply to board meetings and public meetings. And to this point, we are satisfying that. And I think with a hybrid in the future, we will continue to do so. So what I'm looking for from the board tonight is not a vote, it's just merely consensus that you agree that we can start to step into this, use this year to evaluate a hybrid and inform policy. And I would leave it for a board comment or question at this point.
Yeah, I'd say that, you know, I think you and I maybe offline talked about the 3 o'clock meeting times instead of 6 o'clock for most of the meetings. And I think I polled the board members at that. It's been a few months ago and everybody was fine with that. But having said that, the caveat would be that the current board is fine with the 3 o'clock meeting time. We can't predict what future boards may be able to do. But for now, with this board, we're good with 3 o'clock.
Yeah.
Unless something changed for someone since we talked. And then I guess the rest of my comment would just be, and I'll let everybody else kind of weigh in, is that, I think we should follow what the district is doing. We should, the opening, the in-person versus remote, we should just follow along with what the rest of the district's doing. We shouldn't get out ahead by any means.
I appreciate that.
Other board members, what are your thoughts?
I agree.
Looks like everybody just saying they agree. Chief,
I haven't agreed yet.
Except Gordon.
Oh, come on.
This is the problem I have with virtual. I'd like to see us eventually get into where we meet on the board, because this is a perfect example. I'm trying to get in, and then, you know, everybody gets cut out, and it's not that everybody's purposely doing it, you know, or being demeaning or anything, but I'd like to see us to eventually get into where we meet at the boardroom and do our meetings there. And, because the one-on-one, being able to read, being able to It's better interaction and so on and so forth. So eventually I'd like to see us to meet at, in the boardroom. That's all.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's what Chief was saying, is that a hybrid would kind of let people do what they're most comfortable with. And then, so, you know, we'll return to what the new post-pandemic normal is going to be, which if you have that in your crystal ball, you're way ahead of me.
I think that's exactly correct, President Lauer, is that we're gonna use this opportunity to inform what it is we want to do. What does the board want to do? And everybody equal input, and we'll start to develop that. But I do appreciate the board following with the mode of operation of the district. It's been very helpful, certainly for messaging. So thank you for that support over this past year and a half almost, right? So it's been a long time. Thank you.
You're good with that, Gordy.
Well, yeah, I just like to say I just do it on a case by case basis, or, you know, that we always review this and when we can, you know, get into our board meetings. But as it is right now, we have to do for virtual, and then things change, we can open up and go to the back to the board meetings and meeting one on one and doing it that way. So let's just do it. The lack of a better word, case by case, or just, you know, a daily or an ongoing review of it, you know, keep it open.
Okay, thank you.
Yep, absolutely. And then I think we got the information that we need to move forward. And as I mentioned, staff has already been preparing to what does that look like as we transition and what will we have to do. So, but one thing that's not on here that I wanted to mention, I forgot to put it on my list, but I know there was interest from the board on cameras in stations, cameras at different operating buildings. And I just wanted the board to know that Heidi Hicks has already evaluated a lot of our security and safety systems throughout the district. And we have 4 cameras that are up in a trial service. 3 are at stations, but maybe there's more than 4, because 3 are at stations, 1 is at CBOC, and 1 is at the new logistics facility. So it's a different vendor than we've used before. It's different technology, because of course technology just keeps getting better and better. So we have begun the process to evaluate cameras at stations and cameras at buildings in the district. So I just want to pass that along to the board. And that, I believe, concludes the chief's report, unless there's any questions for me.
Thanks, Chief. Any questions?
I have a couple, whether it's now or at the end. It's sort of related to a couple of the topics. Has there been an official prediction about the wildfire season this year? What to expect?
Yeah, and I'll let Chief Holman jump in. He's part of the incident management teams for the Oregon State Fire Marshal's Office. He is our internal weather person, if you will, and he does a great job of it. And I know at ODF and everyone else, they're talking about a very challenging wildfire season. But Chief Holman, if you have anything to add to that, please do.
Sure. Thank you, Chief Weiss, and good question, Director. And yes, the Chief is right. It does not look good. Oregon, June, July, and August, our entire state is going to be at a high risk of wildfires. We're pretty much the entire state's at drought. The Northwest Coordinating Center sets levels, preparedness levels. 1's the best, 5 is the worst. We went to a 3 today. And just like the Chief mentioned earlier, it's June. I never thought we'd be at a 3 in June. So it's going to be a long summer. They are expecting the worst. This pre-positioning, I think, may be a lifesaver on some of these fires. The concern is everything's so dry when these lightning events like we're seeing right now, they get such a quick start ahead of our crews before we get enough resources on scene. So it is going to be a very, very challenging season for the whole West Coast.
Thank you. And just for my own education, the technology is in place so that if we did have to issue evacuation orders, that those notifications go out to cell phones basically anywhere in the district.
We rely on emergency management to do those reverse 911 and that process. So if you're not already aware, the under state statute is actually law enforcement. The sheriff is the only one who has authority to issue evacuation orders. We work hand in hand with the sheriff's office. When the decision is made to do that evacuation, emergency management pulls that plug and does that reverse 911.
Okay, thank you. And then last question, are there talks of when we will allow the public back into the facilities, like to rent the community rooms?
Yeah, well, we are having those conversations, but we're not there yet. And so I wish I could. I can't give you even an estimate. It looks like there might be a change in the next week or so, at least from the governor. But it's that lag time for what does OSHA tell us to do? So I would just be a guess, a shot in the dark, if you will, of when in the coming few months is just a best wag at it. But I don't know for sure.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Thanks, Justin. Any other questions, comments from the board?
Mr. President, I have a question for the chief on the cameras that you talked about. Does that new technology include audio?
Well, I have not heard audio from them in the presentations that I was given. The presentations were video. The technology is really the ability to get that video and be able to get the video in precise times and locations where we didn't have that ability before. It almost went into Neverland and we would have a hard time retrieving the data or the video. Now we can't. I don't know if Chief Hitt knows if off the top of her head, if there's audio, but the one that's at CBOC is inside the building. So it's inside at the front window. And I have not seen the tape from that. So I don't know, unless Chief Hitt knows.
At this time, we are not in turning on any audio components of the video as part of the R&D that we're working on right now.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Chief Hitt.
Anything else from board members? Okay, let's roll into director reports.
Just obvious, I just couldn't get in there fast. I was just also going to comment too, is that on this, the security cameras, are you using, you may not know the answer on this, are you using TV cable or are you using Cat5 for wiring on those? Are they connected up, you know, through the computer system? Just kind of curious. If you don't know, I understand.
Do you want to go, Chief?
Go for it.
They're not wireless. I couldn't tell you the specific type of cable, but it's more computer based, but it is not wireless. And right now the feed goes to the station iPad and officers' iPhones.
Okay, cool. Oh, good. That helps out a lot. That was giving some good information there. Yeah, it sounds like they're more Cat5, which is connect right in there. Computers or anything. Good.
6E that, now, isn't it? What's that? Cat 6 now, isn't it?
Yeah, but I think a lot of them are Cat 5. Right, they are moving over to that. But also, too, that's interesting, too, that they hook up to their iPads and the help out the front door if somebody comes in there at 3 o'clock in the morning for security reasons.
Yeah.
Thank you, the
cable looks just like Cat 5, Cat 6. Whether it is or not, I don't know, but I'm sure CFO Collier would love to run downstairs right now and take a peek. No, I'm kidding, CFO Collier, I'm kidding. But the cable does look like a Cat5 that I used to use in my house. So I'm not sure what it is though.
It's a wired camera system, not a wireless. So that's
indeed
probably more reliable.
Yep.
That's it, yes. Wired. Thank you.
Okay, Gordy, you started. Do you have anything else for director's report here?
Nothing earth shattering other than I got an impact meeting tomorrow. It's virtual, but they have really nothing. It's just more informative, but they down the road, they are looking at some, urban growth agreements. So we'll see what happens down the road. We'll see what happens. That's all I got.
Okay. Thanks. Other directors. What's it called? Whack it going, Bob.
Okay, the WACA facility, the exterior paint job is completed. It looks really nice. The landscaping is completed. The irrigation systems are in. The facility is going to be a rather secure facility. And I'll leave it at that. At our WACA meeting last week, I received news during the meeting that Construction was approximately $4.7 million over what was budgeted. And I got upset with that. And since then, I have found out from Chief Weiss that the people managing the project, the county, actually increased the size of the facility. And those of us that make up the full director board, which we're separate from the CEO board that really runs WACA, most of us were not informed of that fact. So it looks like we're getting a very, very good facility that has a little more room for growth, and looking forward to move in sometime in September. The project still, it seems to have moments where there's a lot of activity and then stuff really slows down. And particularly in the area of sheetrock now, that there are anticipated shortages in sheetrock because when the price was down, some entrepreneurial people bought actual future deliveries, and they have stockpiled sheetrock in warehouses. So that's constricting the supply, and it's increasing the cost. You know, people find opportunities to make money, and they'll take full advantage of it. So stay tuned for more.
Okay. Thanks, Bob. Clark or Justin?
No, I have nothing. Thanks.
Okay. I have nothing.
Okay. Well, I get to read our statement about Juneteenth. So I'd like to take this moment to reflect on a very important holiday that occurred this past Saturday. I want to thank staff for their help with the historical content and for making sure that we didn't bypass this opportunity to highlight its significance along with our diversity, equity, and inclusion values. So June 19th, also known as Juneteenth, was the day when General Gordon Grander arrived in Galveston, Texas, 156 years ago, to inform the last remaining enslaved African Americans of their freedom. This freedom, which they were not aware of until then, had been declared in the Emancipation Proclamation issued more than 2.5 years earlier by President Abraham Lincoln. June 19th, 1865 was a day in history that should never be forgotten, and is a day of celebration for Americans of all races, backgrounds, and religions, as it marked the end of slavery in the United States. That following December, slavery was formally abolished with the adoption of the 13th Amendment. Over the past several weeks, we're grateful to see that House Bill 2168 was unanimously passed by the Senate and House and signed by Governor Brown, officially recognizing Juneteenth as a formal state holiday in Oregon. It's an important day of reflection where we should all acknowledge the imperfect past of our country and play an active role in making it right. Every single day of the year, I can say without hesitation that TVF&R is committed to being an inclusive EMS and fire service provider. Our personnel believe in the essential need for equality and celebrate the diversity of our organization, the communities we serve, and society as a whole. On behalf of the board of directors, we are proud to be part of this organization, and we share the same sentiment to actively weave diversity, equity, and inclusion more tightly into our culture. Thank you, and happy belated Juneteenth. And with that, I think it's a wrap.
Executive session. Very,
I'm sorry.
Oh, Gordon? Go ahead. Not listed on the board. Go ahead.
I think we're ready for an motion to adjourn. Unless you guys want to hang around for a while, we've kind of kept you here for a while today.
We have executive.
Oh, that's right. So we can adjourn this and then we can go to executive, but we don't have to reconvene in regular, correct?
You're not.
Okay. So is there a motion to adjourn the regular session?
And so moved.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Moved and seconded. All in favor? Well, Ashley, poll us, please.
President Lauer.
Yes.
Director Hubbies.
Yes.
Director Dillingham.
Yes.
Director Balfour.
Yes.
Director Weifels.
Yes.
Okay, the regular session is adjourned, and Ashley, when you're ready, we'll be in executive session. And Chief, when you guys are ready.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.